Hey there, it's Modern Retro Tech. We continue in our streams about Rust. This time we will try to make a web UI. In fact, I actually want to try to make a desktop UI, but I thought that using web technologies will be better, mostly because I know them best, and also because normally trying to make desktop apps with the typical desktop workflow will be quite slow and it's not very interactive. Rust is quite unique for making web UIs. So first of all, you can compile to WebAssembly. And second of all, WebAssembly is quite fast. It integrates well with JavaScript. So you can kind of choose how much of the UI you're writing in Rust, how much of that you can write using typical JavaScript technologies. And that's something that I want to try out today. So let's see. Before the stream, I looked at a number of different UI technologies that we can try today, and I found two projects that use WebAssembly and that also have good workflow, it seems, in terms of how you program the stuff and also providing hot reloading and stuff like that. So one of the projects is You. You. That's a pretty funny name. Another one is Seed. I'm not sure what is happening with the plant theme here, but we'll try first this one because it seems to be slightly more popular, or like almost 14k stars compared to 1.4k stars, so like 10 times more popular. Another one that we can try, if that fails, is WebView. So WebView is supposed to be like Electron, but lighter, simpler, faster, all of that. So if we cannot do stuff in WebAssembly, we can try to just go WebView and write React or whatever. Last time we stopped at providing music library interface. So if everything goes well today, we should be able to see that music library scene displayed in our UI. I will be happy if we can show it on some kind of local web server, but if we can package it into a desktop app already, that would be splendid. So let's try the first one out, this U thing. I guess we should go to documentation. And one thing that I want to do right away, I want to convert my Rust project to be a workspace. So far we are just having a normal Rust project. We have, actually let's do it like that. So we have a bunch of things here. We have our cargo toml, cargo log thing. We have SRC directory, and we have target directory and Rust format. Now, what I want to do is to convert it to workspace. How do you typically do that? You typically can do it comparatively easily. We will create a subdirectory. We could call it, I really wonder if you can actually call it the same as the workspace name. We can try it out and see if it works. So we have music box. Now, and we can move stuff there. So we can move SRC into music box. We can move target into music box. So we are not required really to do it, but it makes sense to try to save some compilation time. yeah, of course. Then readme, I will keep here, I guess, but cargo stuff goes also into our new subdirectory. And Rust FMT, we can leave here. Music itself, we can also leave here, I guess. Yeah, but we probably will need to change our code a bit. So now we can create another cargo toml thing here. And if you look at our editor, yeah, we can close to the right. Actually, let's close everything for now, because this stuff doesn't really exist anymore. I think we shouldn't see SRC here, right? Maybe we need to refresh Explorer. Nice. Nothing happens. This stuff I will remove this stuff. I will move here. So all the stuff about authentication. I will quickly close and open my editor because I think I'm confusing the hell out of it. So we can do it like that. Then we can do it like that. Yeah. Yeah, sure, sure, sure. So now we can create a workspace in here. I always forget the syntax about it, so workspace. So that's the thing. And one thing that we need here is music box. That should be it in principle, by the way. Formatting should be two spaces. I wonder if it will now compile so we can, oh, it actually has for some stupid reason. Why does it have this? That's awkward. Yeah, okay, okay. So we can, I think, drop this directory actually. And now we can try to build. We will see how much time it will take. This Rust, you never know. Oh well, we are rebuilding everything from scratch, so saving target did not really help. Well, while that happens, we can look at the U thing. So yeah, it's modern Rust web framework for creating multi-threaded front-end web applications with WebAssembly. Let's make it a bit easier to read. Component-based, nice. Similar to React and Elm, nice. Great performance, sure. JavaScript interoperability. Okay. Okay, we can join them. Are we ready to dive in? Yeah, we are ready to dive in. We will need Rust. We have Rust. I think we have WASM pack already. Yeah, we do. So you can apparently start doing this stuff with like one of the three ways they provide here. So you can do it with WASM pack, you can do it with WASM bingen, or you can do it with cargo web. I'm trying to figure out which one we should use. I guess we'll go for WASM pack because I already have it, and plus it was kind of nice. I tried to write the WASM tutorial app, which is like a game of life that you just write in WebAssembly. It was pretty cool. It was a bit weird because you need to copy several templates, and then it's a bit painful because they have a bunch of stuff already built in that you need to remove, which I don't really like that much. But otherwise, supported is Webpack, supported, everything supported, and we have a starter template. Okay. And tooling for front end with simple blah blah blah. One web season, yeah, WASM bingen and WASM pack. But this template integrates in many common web technologies. So the difference then? Okay, it uses yarn. It uses rollup. Oh god. So the thing is, with rollup and stuff like that, you kind of always, it's not the standard stuff that you use in most projects, right? And as far as I remember, rollup was actually quite nice, but that can add additional overhead for whatever we try to do. So like, okay, using WASM pack. Cargo install WASM pack, bundle, serve, okay. That doesn't look too reassuring, I must admit. I would have preferred to have one command to set everything up for me. Sorry, I'm a bit spoiled. By the way, let's try to see if our app runs now since it was built. Yeah, it misses everything. Oh, okay, I'm dumb. I should have actually moved it here. Okay. Oh, yeah, we need to do the relogging now. So go here. We got the code. You see, we really need an interface to not do it every time manually. It's a bit annoying. Okay. Pass the code. We save the token. We got a bunch of artists. Okay, sounds good. Okay, this stuff looks like a hella lot of work to set up. Let's look at it. So, front end, blah, 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 minimal overhead, all the benefits, macro-based syntax, clear documentation, written without any unsafe. They have also a nice example. You'll notice minimal configuration. Okay, that sounds way better already. But make file. okay, so we need to do the cargo generate thing. Profile of this quick start. Make sure Git doesn't automatically convert your new lines to CLRF because linters don't like it. I haven't seen this stuff for a while. I guess this is something that you get from Windows integration. Cargo make. So all those, both of those seem to have rather unique story about how to build stuff. Modify. Cargo make watch. Oh, refresh your browser and see changes. Okay, that's not something we will be doing. That's for sure. If we don't have hot reloading, I'm out of us there. So that's pretty deal breaking thing. Okay, web view itself. I guess we have no choice. We should try this U thing. So I really don't like rollup. Can we try to build something maybe without this stuff? Oh, there is another thing, which is build a sample app. You create this. Oh man, okay. So they actually show you how to build this scene on your own. Okay, so we don't need to do all the stuff. I'm really happy to hear that. So let's do cargo new lib. And how do we call it? We will call it UI. When it's not workspace. This may be by adding UI to the workspace member. Yeah, sure we do. So we will do UI. We now have UI. So here it should be empty. It is. Okay, good. There is just like test scene. We can do cargo build. So, and we should also in principle, I actually wonder, does this stuff end up here, music box, lib music box, okay. Because I'm trying to understand if it actually built it. Okay, I'm not sure. We can do cargo build UI maybe. Wallet. Okay, fine. I guess we will be running it anytime soon, so we can try it later on. First, create a library to your dependencies. So, okay, let's check if that is, yeah, it is correct version because they thankfully write version here. So we go here, we add this, copy the following template. Okay, copy paste time. Oh, actually, stop. Before we do that, let's check that we can run tests. So test. So now we should build this stuff and we should be able to run tests there, right? I hope so, at least. Updates in CreateSIO index. Well, some Rust problems, aren't they? I really wonder what it does right now. So like, does it unload stuff? Can we do it like in verbose mode or something like that? Well, while it does it, let's try to figure out what this template actually does. So we take the prelude thing. Oh, something's happening. Failure to resolve address. Whoa. Please don't tell me that GitHub is down. Oh, that probably won't work, right? I don't remember if you can actually ping directly by hostname. Domain name. I think it wouldn't, but just in case, so let's see that we are fine. Well, we are fine. And my connection thing also shows that everything is fine. So let's try again. And just in case. Oh well. That will be very funny. Can my internet be down? That will be super weird. So let's see, everything is fine so far. If I open Chrome and try from it. Whoa. Okay, if I try to do something very different, for example, instead of GitHub or Chrome, what can I open? I'm sorry about that, but that hasn't happened before. I wonder what the hell it is. No, my internet actually works, at least on my mobile. Network thing. Can I do... That should also do a network call, right? Failed. Which is really good. So... While that is happening, let's return back to our stuff here. So they use the prelude, they create a model, component link. Ooh, sounds crazy. They have a message. They have properties. Okay, tests has run. A bit weird, running zero tests. Why? Okay, let's go a bit deeper. So let's go to UI. Let's try to test directly here. Oh man, Rust does love to compile stuff. Now we have this stuff. So it takes the reference to self, to the component, it takes a message, it returns should render thing, whatever it means. And then it, depending on the messages, it changes the model. Makes sense. Change to previously received properties. This component has no property, so we will always return false. Okay, that seems like should component update from React, if you know what I'm talking about. And view, that's actually the most exciting part about this scene, because they have syntax similar to JSX, essentially. So you can do like button on click, blah, 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 right here. And then you can render some diff. And then you have run up. Okay, here it runs tests. Now we know that it works at least. We can take this template and put it here. And then code model, finally, into new folder name static in your app. Okay. Oh, not stasis. static. Okay. And here we need to add index.html, and that index.html should do this. Okay. Thankfully, have a formatter. And now we can ready cargo install, build and start development with JavaScript. Okay. Oh, yeah, we need to do this thing. I completely forgot. This is required, I think, for all WebAssembly things. So, right, okay, I guess let's do it like that. Let's remove this stuff. Let's make this work. Now we can try to do it again. Oh, yeah, well, let's recompile everything once more. I really don't get why it always needs... Ah, well, here, I guess it needs to recompile everything because it has different binary output format, right? So before that, it compiled for like native code, and now it's compiled into WebAssembly. So that's why it needs to do that. Oh, man. But still, I wish there was some kind of caching that actually... Okay, actually, how would it work here? I have no clue. Normally, you would have some kind of caching for just for the stage just before you emit binary, right? In this case, I guess they don't use it, which is a bit sad. Okay, well, we wait for that. What else will they ask us to do? Choosing a web library. And then there are like components and stuff, and HTML macro, and services. There is also router. We won't go super deep anyways today, I think. Maybe half of the stream we will be waiting for compilation. Sorry, Rust problems. Alternatively, yeah, so like the goal is just to display something and make sure that we can connect it to our logic in the main music box crate. And fancier stuff we will probably do next stream, where we actually try to render a bit more things. For now, just rendering artists from our library will be sufficient for me. If, of course, we will ever finish waiting for compilation to finish. So let's see what they tell us about choosing a web library. U apps can be built with either WebSys or STDWeb. These two crates provide the binding between Rust and Web API. So you need to choose one or the other when you're adding U to your cargo dependencies. Choose WebSys. Choose, okay, it uses WebSysIn. So let's look how alive those things are. So WebSys is a bit more popular, I guess. Wasm Binken. Okay, so this WebSys scene is part of Wasm Binken. Oh God. So I guess that will be better. Window. Expect. Alert this message. Oh man. Did they rename everything? STD Web. Chess. Startler, they serve roughly the same purpose with similar functionality. Actively maintained, no GitHub activity. Okay, Rust AP takes conservative approach. Yeah, something finished, just 3 minutes. Description, repository, and license. Wasm package. So now in static, we got a bunch of things. We got index, we got package, JSON. We got Wasm files themselves. So there's like TypeScript definitions. Yeah. So there is, this is a TypeScript thingy that is JS thingy that probably loads everything. Looks scary. What else do we get? And the Wasm file itself, well, this is binary. We can open it in Hex editor. So I wonder, oh, you can even see all the fancy stuff here, right? So wbindgen object drop ref. Looks even scarier. I wonder how much it weights this. Actually, just let's do this static, and then we can do this. So the JS thing is 16 kilobytes, and Wasm thingy is 104 kilobytes. I think there is some specific compiler options you can set to make it less. For now, we wouldn't care about that. It's still not 50 gigabytes of memory that Slack app requires, but Wasm Binken, Wasm Pack, Wasm la 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 for most IP. So STD Web is also panicky. Okay, nice. So and now how do we serve it? I guess we can serve it with Python, right? Yeah, I guess so. So whoa, something works. That's pretty cool. We can press plus one. Okay. Now I wonder, I guess nothing will happen. Yeah, nothing yet will happen if I change my code. So now we need to somehow make it work with hot reloading. And also, but first, by the way, it still doesn't use my Rust format. I think my, I'm sorry, but I think my editor is still a bit confused about where we are right now. So let me again close it. Yeah, let me again open it. So now, no, we don't want to restart. No, no. Okay, thank you. So now I hope it will be able to recognize everything properly. Let's make this scene a bit less. And let's look at our sources. So, yeah, of course, now cargo check also needs to download everything again. Okay, let's let it run. Let's go back here and let's see how we can actually make it auto-reload. So does it write anything about that? So they have like build sample app, choose, introduce refs, elements, overview format, advanced topics, how it works, debugging, CSS testing apps. They don't write anything specifically about that, but since we are using Wasm Pack, build bundle. Why do you use rollup? Command line OS through JavaScript API. Let's try to see the starter template thing. So this is, and using Cargo Web is that this approach uses a lib node to bing grid, and the entry point of your program is in that with Wasm bing and annotation. So that's our entry point. Okay. That you create this CD lib and uses parcel. Parcel I have never used before, but I heard about it quite a lot recently. It seems to be a new tool de jour in JavaScript community because it doesn't require you to write super complex configurations the way the Webpack thingy requires you to write them. So that may be actually good. What's the license? This is MIT. And without source code. Nice. But that I think is quite a bit of stuff, no? What is in package JSON? Express. Oh, 9. And here, oh. Okay. That looks, that is good because I, in any case, prefer to use SAS over plain CSS. So that I will need anyways. Webpack, I can live with. It's not the most exciting technology, honestly. I feel we should have forked JavaScript. Like, you know, okay, this is unrelated rant, but we should have forked JavaScript years ago. You should have created a proper language, minimal language with a separate version. You should have been able to switch to it, and this shit should not we should not have needed this kind of stuff, where you need to have like Babel and Webpack and all the other stuff to just run you up. This is a bit crazy, but that's the world we are living in right now. So, two commits behind. Why, by the way, Wasm backed the plate? Ah, yeah, because they forked it. I really don't want to use yarn thing. Where do they put the code? Oh my God, this is so annoying, GitHub. You are a code repository. Can you stop hiding code every time I try to look at it from smaller window? So they have, here is a app. They have statics the same way we do anyways, which is nice. Then they have tests that have Netlify. Netlify is the thing that deploys stuff, I think. I forgot what it means. I think, okay, so it's like CDN and stuff like that. Then we have gitignore, cargo.toml. Does it include anything we don't include? Strum, sorta, vrlog. What is strum? Rust. Okay. That we won't need, I guess. I hope so, at least. Static. We have two licenses. And Bootstrap.js, what does it do in Bootstrap? We don't have Bootstrap.js. No, we don't have Bootstrap.js. Ah, okay, it just does this. Okay. And then we have package.json. Okay, let's add this. So I guess we will just steal the code as very bad people. Oh, shit. Where were we? No. Yes, thank you. So package JSON. It's on the same level as CargoTuml, right? Yes, it is. I'm not sure what this means, so that we won't need, I think. Then we got a bunch of echo node as specified, webpack mode development, web mode production, webpack dev server, wasm copy webpack sas wasm cli. Okay, sure. Next thing will be we got this. We now should be able to do webpack config. So right. So let's see what does this thing do. Require pass, wasm2, copy, dist, model, export, bootstrap JS. Output. So name of our thing will be UI. Static node TypeScript production bootstrap.js. Another thing that we will need is bootstrap.js then. Yeah, you can in principle use stuff like cargo generate to generate directory already with all this stuff, but I prefer to go through that manually and copy stuff that I actually need instead of copying everything, because then you add up with like GitHub workflows that they have, Netlify and all other stuff. And then it also can break, and then you can spend a lot of time trying to debug while it actually broke. So we now we don't have that yet. So I really don't know if it will work, but let's try it. How do you start it? I guess you just do like, yeah. So we do npm. Oh, no. Big awful mistake. We don't need to do npm here. I hope. Yes, thankfully it didn't do anything. We just need to go to UI and here we can do npm install. That hopefully shouldn't take as much time. So, well, maybe I was a bit too optimistic. After all, programming is just waiting for a very long time nowadays. But it seems that we are progressing. Okay, found zero vulnerabilities. Has it ever happened before? Now we can do start dev. And now, yes, yeah. Okay, but look, now it does what I wanted to do. It recompiles everything in Rust as well. So I guess when I will start changing the code, it doesn't work yet because it needs to recompile everything once more. Wait until bundle finished, but it even writes you some nice error message. I really like it. Of course, we got 5,000 Node.js modules. That stuff is always so amazing. Okay, we have been compiled. Compiled successfully. Everything is very successfully compiled. everything is now working, and now we can try the to test finally live reload. So let's go here and let's change the text on the button. So it compiled successfully, but maybe I'm too dumb, but they changed the button name. Why doesn't it change? Okay. We don't have anything else. I'm thinking that maybe we still have the old server that I started with Python running. So let's see. Doesn't seem so. So I have IPython, but it doesn't do that. So it's a different thing. Do we actually? Okay. It doesn't seem that this thing changes, no matter what I do. Maybe I can change the value here. Nothing changes. Well, it looks definitely like it is responding to me refreshing the page. It just doesn't do anything. Bundle finish. I really wonder. So we are in the correct directory. We can start this stuff here. It has the node modules. It has everything else. There is a magical command. You can check who is listening on the port. I think it is something like that. Okay. Beautiful. So running on specific port. Ah, it's minus I, okay. Minus I, will it accept just support? Known protocol name, okay, TCP. So the only thing running here is this, and this is node, and I'm pretty sure that this is our Webpack dev server. So we are serving from the correct process. That's one thing that I sometimes spend a lot of time trying to debug it when you have multiple instances of a web server. For example, one is losing synchronization with the directory, and you try to change code, nothing updates, you hit your head against the wall. In this case, I'm just not sure that it can even do the auto-update properly. So hot reloading, how does this thing work? So where was this? Last impact template. Like, also another thing is that I don't actually see any problems with the stuff that we generate, right? We have the server. Okay, let's also check that we actually serve stuff from the correct index.html. So here, does it say use sample? Let's change the name of the tab to music box UI. Like, in principle, okay, now it updates. So at least we can update HTML itself. That's already good. But yeah, you can see it shows music box UI thingy here. Then we import init from wasm.js. Maybe I screw up. Oh, yes, from UI.js, of course. does it really? So it creates this package scene here, and it calls this, yeah, we import from it, we get module, and then we call run app. And here it creates just index stuff. And in webpack config, I said that this is your entry in Bootstrap and output is dist pass, which is dist. But file name, I said index. But they also had something different in the template, right? It was a bit weird. So index, it actually says index bg wasm. Well, who knows? So maybe just if we now restart it. And if we try to do our changes again, so nothing happens still. Obviously, something doesn't work. Has it even rebuilt those index BG stuff? Index BG was? Index BG was package bootstrap. I don't see anything wrong with this config anymore. That's the problem with using Webpack. Something breaks, you have no clue how to fix it. But even weirder thing that this doesn't change at all. It feels like I really need to just do cargo build. Yeah, and then I start it. Will it change? It still doesn't change. It still says plus one. It feels like it just doesn't really use it. Okay, let's try to look through this stuff a bit more. So what does, I will restart it and we will look at how it, what it writes. So checking for WasmPack. WasmPack is installed. Compiling your crate in development mode. The pack output is served from this. Served from music box UI dist. Checking for the WASM, compiling to WASM, origin crate has no readme, whatever. Optional, is ready to publish. Your crate has been correctly compiled. Everything's good so far. We get hash, we get time, we get blah, blah, blah. And then we get the stuff that it actually serves, I think, right? Package, index. So that it finds, that it doesn't necessarily find. Entry point. Entry point mine, package index.js, pg, wasm, 34 hidden modules compiled successfully. So it everything looks correct, right? There is no like errors, no nothing here. Yet we don't get hot reload. So I actually wonder if I break it. So if I say here instead of that, I want string. That should break everything to hell, right? Oh yeah, so it breaks it. So it does react to Rust code. But then when I do this, it should have, so. Via UI package. Right now it's 1559. So this stuff was just regenerated. In principle, we should expect to see that it includes our changes, but somehow it doesn't. Maybe we can try to serve it in another port and see that there is indeed no like weird processes happening. What was our soft thing if I stop it? I think TCP, something like that, right? Nothing is listening to that now. Okay. Then, what else can we try to do with this? So this index.js just loads WASM thing. It has a bunch of stuff for memory management. Let's open it with Hex editor and see if it includes the magical word yo. So invalid query. Maybe I can notice it here. Bunch of stuff. Doesn't look like what we are looking for. Also, I really don't get where is actually the scrolling thing? Can I see the scroller here somewhere? It feels like it's just endless. Okay, I guess that won't really work. But actually, I think there were some tools for debugging WebAssembly, right? So I think you can convert it to like Lisp-like thingy. Now we closed everything. You also have this stuff in static, right? I wonder if it's updated actually. So let's try to check it out as well. That stuff hasn't been updated for a while. I'm thinking, oh man, maybe that's the reason. What if I just drop this stuff? So I will take this and say bye-bye. And now, sure. So now let's try to run it again. Oh, what was the magical command? Start dev. Nothing appears there. Well, nothing appears here either. But the title is correct somehow. I wonder. Ah, here it happens. So instead, we probably should just go like to package and like load index.js, right? Or something. And this index.js will do the stuff. Actually, we can even skip that, I think, and maybe just okay, let's comment this out and do script. Come on, script. Yes. And for src we just say package, and we need index.js, and that is it, I think. Right? Nothing happens. Let's look again at our starter template. So this is like minimal thing. We need the thing that is WASM pack. Okay, does it embody? says to do MVC. Ah, I guess that's what it expects. It expects that it will output stuff here, but somehow, like here, we should get the... Actually, maybe it's even like that. Yo, it works. Okay, after much struggle, we were able to make this thing work. That is not an easy process to repeat. So we can try now to do a bit more stuff. So we can try to see if changing our library now changes things. So yeah, we already know, let's switch it back to zero. Okay, I triggered that. Let's try it again. Let's say instead of yo, let's write add one. Not touching anything. Yo, okay, live reload works.
Yeah.
Okay, let's commit this magical state while we can. So, let's add SRC, let's add music box. Oh, it probably added, will it actually add music and like stuff like that? I am not sure. Let's see what to try to add. So, first let's add UI thing. So we were able to make some very, very simple interface and we now have hot reload. Next step then will be to actually try to connect it to our existing code and try to make it work with it. So we should be able to fetch stuff from our library on Spotify with that. Okay, we are not committing node modules. So now we have flip main Spotify deleted because they're now in that directory, bootstrap, package log, package JSON, libras, webpack config. So we have this package thing and static thing. While by the well, that we don't want to ignore. So sorry. So that works. Now, sure. And now we need to do music box. So let's see what it contains now, because it also was taken for some reason very long time. So we have target. I think target should already ignore. So now it should work fast. Yes, it does. And yeah, renamed. Correct. Okay, good. U integration one. And now we can commit it, and let's quickly look at the state we have in the repository. So we have this. It's all our code, nice. We have this. Yep, Is it with our... Yeah. Looks correct. We also should see our magical configs here. So webpack. Wasmpack plugin. Yeah. Looks nice. Bootstrap. Looks nice. Let's give it some style, first of all. That should be very simple to do. So here we can do something like... I don't know. And just to test it. Of course, nothing yet changes, but if we go to our Bootstrap thing, we should be able to import it as module. And it works. Nice. So, okay, we can now remove the ground color thing. We can set font size to, I don't know, 14. I'm not sure it actually works on button, but on this it works, right? But okay, we will do more fun with CSS next time. Yeah, okay, sorry. Hard to restrain myself. Now, with that in mind, we can try to call our music library thing. Music box scene, I mean. Thankfully, it has already a trait for lib trait. So we can just, in principle, depend on that from here. Not from JavaScript. What this stuff is doing here? I think it's from GitLens. I really need to... GitLens, welcome. Don't show stuff. Status bar, allow, default, show, GitLens, sidebar. Why do you appear here? This is so weird. I don't need you. Okay, I will figure it out later on. So, in CargoTOML, we can now, in principle, depend on our stuff. So I think you can do it like that. You can say music box and then say pass. I think seems so. Ooh. So this is our, yeah, this is webpack. Cannot find allocation granularity. Allocation granularity. Well, I feel that we will, that won't work. Yeah, it won't work. I guess we will need, let's try to do it with this we alloc. I think they have it in the template, so... I'm thinking that those errors may be explained because it doesn't have allocator by default. So if we add an allocator, it may actually work. Nah. Oh man. F- fail to compile. So that, not all trait items. I want to try to do it like that so that we can just scroll up and see all the errors we get. Okay. Okay, because our playback theme includes native dependencies as well, even if we have a locator, it won't really help us at all. Because then we cannot really make them compile to WASM, right? So that means Rodeo would not compile to WASM, which means no U for us. Okay, so what it means then for our attempts to develop stuff? I guess we can try to do React. We can try to do React with WebView. That is not super exciting thought, but I think that's the only thing that will work. Fail. But at least we tried it. We now know that U works as long as you don't need any native dependencies and no transitive dependencies you have work require native compilation. It might just work for you. Or maybe not, who knows. In any case, I will commit the current state without this stuff. And let's try to set up a new project. As I promised, this stream is trying stuff out, so what? Sure. Okay. Now that's what we committed, and now we delete it. Let's try attempt number two. So use stuff we can all close. Of course, we could have done something different, right? We could have had like clear up. We could have then just generated binaries separately and called it from you. But that kind of removes all the benefit of writing front end and back end in the same language. Because then you need to build backend separately, you need to create the whole integration layer. So that's something that is also kind of a deal breaker for me. The only other things that I tried for writing graphic user interfaces in Rust before was GTK. That was awful. Compiling all the dependencies and figuring out which things you need to install for macOS was absolutely horrific. And the experience was also like the stuff that it draws to you, at least by default, looked very bad. So I don't want to go this way. And we are not going WASM way either. Then what we then try is just plain old WebView. Does it require any magics? Does it require anything weird in terms of so it has like ArcticX, blah, 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 Serde, Volktia, Grep. Okay, fine. Not super scary so far. It's made simple via nwebview eval Rust function. So there is like a way to call JavaScript functions from Rust and the way to call Rust functions from JavaScript, which sounds good. But I'm still trying to figure out how it will actually work. So will it just run like the desktop part, like the server part in another thread, I guess? Yeah, it's like all way better than Electron. It uses WebKit. If you're planning, okay, we don't plan to do it on Linux, but of course it's a plus if it can also compile on Linux, but I don't use Linux for nowadays at home. I only use it for like servers, where of course I wouldn't care about playing music much, so not a big concern. We create, can be found, you have to do dependency, so Edge, we don't want to use content with, so here you can take the HTML and then, so it means we don't even need to have like a separate thing, right? Well, I will still have a separate thing just for the sake of separating concerns a bit, and also for in case that fails, so that we don't need to constantly reformat music box when we try stuff. Because if that fails, we will just go with web, React, whatever app, and not care about it much, right? I also wonder if we can, like, this is WebView thing. It can render this content. Can it actually render Edge? Okay, I don't care. Now we use Rust and Terraform to awesome.js, like you. So maybe we did removal of you a bit earlier than was needed. But I actually, to be honest, like, does it make much sense to write in it for frontend? Frontend is not a thing for which you need such a hardcore thing. Adding a con. But at least it sells, it support Elm and PureScript, so this is good. I wouldn't really use Elm, but we can try just to write basic React. Maybe I will try to use U again. Who knows? And parser. Okay, let's try it. Yeah. Almost running out of time. I will need to go at 5 sharp, so we have 40 minutes. So we create a new thing. Ah, actually, our whole U thing is. Ah, no. This is just shell that is fucked. So. Should we check it out? Should we try to use it still? Is this WebView thing? I guess. But then also, how do we. So, like. How do we do communication? I'm just trying to understand if we still have U stuff, which cannot depend on music box, because music box depends on Rodeo, and Rodeo depends on native dependencies to actually decode different music formats. That means that we need to call this somehow, WebView Builder, invoke handler. Ah, so that works, I guess, yeah, when you do external invoke, that passes stuff here. So that means that in principle, we can create like a message layer for WebView app. WebView app can in principle depend both on UI thing, which then wouldn't need to depend on Rodeo, on music box, which depends on Rodeo. And then we can pass stuff there. But that will be like 3 projects. So it will be more complex than normal web development, because normally you have just like 2 projects or something. And here you will have 3 things. You will have the UI, you will have the backend, and you will have a thing that creates a desktop app and bridge and connects frontend and backend. That will be a very confusing setup to work with. Should we then just do like another approach, of course, would be just to do a server-side rendering, right? If we do server-side rendering, then in principle we can then just return HTML from our UI thing. This is so confusing. To align your assets. Look more professional. I think they also have examples, right? So how you can... Yes. This is like Elm counter. This is just an Elm map. Okay. Nothing super fancy there. And if they want to use, and this is this view. Encounter. So how do you they integrate it? They just do it like that. But then the thing is that doesn't require you to get any data from Rust part. So for me it is a bit less interesting because this is like only front end, right? There is no like actual integration happening between the Rust part and the front end part. I hear it does like HTML and that includes it and that it invokes. So here the actual interop seems to happen. Yeah. So it has this user data, you have stuff, and then it invokes it. And then it sets title. So that's how interops works. This is in to-do Elm, so okay, this is generated JavaScript, not very interesting for us. This is interesting for us. So when we, for example, add task, we create Rust command, and Rust command is this encode Rust command. Encodes it into an object. Okay, I see. Then, what else do they have? Counter and with actics, what they do with actics? Okay, so they really like run backend and stuff. Okay, so we can interop, but it won't be very easy. At the same time, I think how many events we actually need to emit, right? The main problem will be like modeling play queues and stuff, otherwise, and search, because then you will actually need to pass a bunch of stuff. That sounds so junky. I'm inclined to think that maybe we should give up on web part and try Iced. Since that looks simple to use, batteries included, responsive layout. Window in shell. Does it use Winit? Web runtime, built-in renderer. It also uses Elm architecture. Okay, you know, I think that's super easy to set up by comparison. The main problem will be we probably wouldn't get hot reload, right? Has update logics and stuff, and sandbox. WebView or Iced? Iced to WebView. What is better? Thing is, my goal is not to develop the craziest possible, the fastest possible UI. My goal is to not go crazy while developing something. This frontend, it is a very tough thing to ask, of course, but I have some hopes. Well, this thing is also uses like its own model. Okay, let's try web view. At least here, and I know that we can set up a normal project. So do we want still to try you? Okay, let's try it. I set it up. I now kind of feel bad about deleting it. It probably was a mistake because now it will probably require me to npm run. Let's change one thing because that is driving me a bit crazy. So this star dev, let's just call it watch. Now it doesn't like it. Oh God. Okay. I made a big awful mistake of actually removing this thing because now it will need to install stuff. But while it does that, we can see how we can also start creating web view thing then. I think it doesn't require as much pain as we needed to go through before, right? So that's the only thing that we will need. Otherwise, we can just cargo new desktop, I guess. Yeah, sure. So here, we can start looking at this. And now, of course, so our web view, you think already works, right? Yeah, it does. So desktop things, then we can test the integration of those both things. So I also wonder how you actually then make web view recognize it. I guess we will need to learn. So we take prelude to that, and then we can look at the examples to see how it serves stuff. So vcare, does it do you? Yes, it does. So then, assets, Arctic web server. To Arctic web server. And this scene does what? Arctic example web get assets. And assets go here. Okay, is there something simpler for us to run? For example, if I just see if Yaograd styles scripts. Ah, so that how it does it. Well, I'm fine with doing that too. I think I wonder if I can just pass a link to that really. So let's do builder, let's do title. Music box. Let's do content. Here we can either pass URL or we can pass HTML. And HTML, what does it want? It wants T. A string containing literal HTML. Okay. User data. Okay, that stuff at least works again. That thing. Maybe it can do something simpler. Like, I want to go for the simplest possible. Oh, it says minimalize. Well, we can try it, of course, just for fun. Not sure. Oh, wow, it works. That's pretty cool. Whoa, it's smooth. Wow, okay, I am impressed. That looks super nice. And it indeed works just like a normal browser window, pretty much. Okay, I guess then we are going whole way. Still the Elm counter thing, how did it do Elm counter? Ah, you can do include string, so that how you can do that. Yay! I'm so content HTML. Ah. Okay. Of course, it's not a thing here, and probably it needs macro. Yeah. Couldn't read no such file or directory. So we need to go to UI, and in UI, we need to go to static. And then we got that. Desktop SRC. Oh, yeah. Okay, let's try to run it again. Nothing happens, I guess. So, why nothing happens? Maybe we can try to, so this thing just takes index.js, which is generated by this thing. So it is already running, right? In principle, we can, of course, I wonder if that will actually work. So let's try to, I'm feeling so adventurous right now. We can say localhost 8000, and then we can try to run it. There is no application set to. Okay. Maybe I need to do that. Yes, okay, we have this stuff working in this WebView thing, and it executes our WebAssembly. Whoa, that's pretty cool. Now, the main problem, of course, that only works. Oh, no. But then maybe that's also a way to live reload stuff. Shit, I just got it. Can I also move it there so I can see what it does? Can you? No, you cannot. Okay, then we quickly move in this things here so that we can see all three at the same time. And of course, this stuff will go somewhere. Actually, it can go even here. Yes. And one thing where macOS is not the best operating system is window management. And I have like all those other things. Oh man. Okay, that is a bit easier, so I can at least see what I'm doing. Come on. Okay. So now we have, this is our website. This is a desktop app. And it's just running right now. And this is my Webpack thing. And now, if I go to, not to index.html, I don't care about it. I want to change Rust code to see that it actually changes stuff, right? So that I don't care about. That is the UI thing. And here is my libRS. So here is my Rust code. So for example, I want now to make it -1. And if it works with hot reloading, I should see it changing here on our web in UI and also in our desktop. So okay, it happened here and it happened here. Yay! We have desktop UI working through WebView with WebAssembly that is written in Rust with hot reloading. That is pretty amazing. But right now, this stuff only works when you're running boss Webpack here, Webpack development server. And we are running this stuff here. I now start to understand why they also wanted ActX in as examples, because if you have ActX, ActX can also do hot reloading, right? And it means that then we can, it will be kind of a workflow, even if you without Webpack and this stuff. But that maybe will be a topic for another time. Now we need to verify that we can integrate with our actual music box library. So first of all, let's see. Here, I don't expect any problems from this like desktop app, desktop thing to integrate with music box because it is executed natively. So what will be the problem? So we can try to do it again. Right. We can stop it and we can run it again. So now it works. Now the thing that we need to do, we will need to pass some kind of message there, right? So we still didn't figure out actually how to integrate it for the figure out how to work without, how it should work without Webpack dev server. We probably will need to, actually, can we already do that? So if I do that and I close it and I open it, can it? No, it still doesn't want to for some weird reason. But it doesn't return errors either. It feels like it just doesn't find this file, right? Because that's something that Webpack creates, I think. So like, so that it can actually call it index.js from here. And in this case, it doesn't really find it, but okay. That we can solve next time. For now, we can be satisfied that we got this working. One thing now that I want to add here is some basic responding to messages, right? So maybe I can make it a bit smaller and this a bit bigger. So, first of all, let's just get our artists. So, we can actually just, let's not make it too complex. Let's just take it from here. Why do we even have play local still there? It's not used anywhere, right? Yeah, we just added for testing local playback. Okay, we can keep it there for now, I think. So, init music box. Sure. Right. So then we create a library thing. And that's actually what we want to return, right? So then we can do this, and then that will be like that, I guess. Or actually, yeah, then we can do get artists. So this will be a vector of artists. And now we can try to send it as user data, right? So I really wonder, I guess we will need to make JSON out of it. But let's see what's the right about user data here. Ideas. Compiling. Readme suggestions. Ideas for app. Showcases. Okay. Then I can just go to crates.io to get documentation. Oh. So, it's a bug. User data, methods. Set the initial state of user data. This is an arbitrary value stored on the web, use thread accessible from dispatch closures without synchronization overhead. So it just kind of stores reference to the stuff we store here, right? So in our case, we can just say, can we actually store a mutable thing there? I wonder. So I don't know. For example, actually, I want to, can I do that? No, okay, let's just pass it by like that. Then we have like invoke handler stuff. So how do we can get this user data in the WebAssembly part of thing? So, oh yeah, first of all, so let's check that it still works. Yeah, of course, it requires us to reauthorize
So we get the code.
We then get this stuff here. We paste it. We save token. We got it. Okay. So at least we know that this logic at least happens also when we start the desktop up, which is good. Then we can try to see how we can use. You know, set the invoke handler callback when a message is received from JavaScript. I think they had. Maybe they have it in examples as well, actually, Wanda, where they need to pass some initial state to the app. So let's just search for that. User data, empty vector, WebView task links, WebView user data mute. Oh, so you can actually get mutable reference to that, which sounds pretty cool. And then it creates from string arg and wraps, depending on what we got. So we definitely will need Serda and Serda JSON anyways, which is fine. We can leave this at. I wonder if we need specific versions or something. So all of that, I guess. That we need to add only to desktop thing, I guess. How it will actually work? I'm just trying to also think about that. So we have that dependency, we had those things. But like when I work on the WebAssembly thing, where I'm still not fully getting the whole lifetime, you know, from getting like, we need to pass somehow this user data thing there. But then what happens when, for example, we execute some action? Like, it's a bit mind-breaking still. But I guess we will figure it out while we go. So we now need to change invoke handler, right? So it takes WebView and it takes arg. Actually, and then it's just the closure here. So transition. Oh, I hate it when it removes stuff. What is CMD? I wonder. There's no such thing as CMD. Yes, I guess it's just models that they use for render. That's the messages they have, and they can then set stuff here. So WebView set color. How do they get it in JavaScript side though? So how do you get the user state? My function external invoke. So okay, this is Rust part, and JavaScript part is here. So they should somehow get tasks, right? RPC invoke. And RPC is a thing, Windows external invoke JSON stringify init. So they dispatch like init command, I guess. And when they dispatch init command, this thing then, what does it do? It, on init, it does nothing. okay. It does nothing, but because also, then for example, if we add something here, if we add a task, we say add task name name. It adds the task, it task pushes, name done, false, task length, set title, render, web view, and render web view RPC render web view eval. What? Ah, okay, so Picadom patch old node. Okay, okay, let's try to look at some simple things. So maybe here. Port stress subscribe. JSON stringify data. So that opens port. But then, if we try to see what that does, so when we add task here, send to Rust. Tasks. Because it also needs to keep track of tasks locally, right? Do they just like synchronize state between both of them? Seems so. That kind of sucks, right? Like then you need to have two states everywhere. It's a bit weird. Can we find anything even more minimal? We just need to pass one little data structure. So like the same minimal RS. To view, graceful exit. Ah, they actually have view. Oh my god, I'm so dumb. But I'm not looking there. So here, sure. So here they have state. Then they have messages, and then they have edit. So this is like, this is also still stuff happening inside you. We create entry, we push it, we say state value, we get, it's like all logic seems to happen here actually, I think. I don't think it actually fetches any state from Rust. From like the WebView app itself. I think WebView app just drops this stuff. We need to verify, but assets. Oh man, that looks complex. So that spawns another thing. Ah, so they just don't use user data in this example. Of course they don't. That would have been too simple, right? Okay, we will need to figure it out ourselves. And the documentation is spotty at best. Examples are also not super relevant, but it was so... But I'm so impressed about how fast this thing actually works. So I think it makes sense to invest a bit of time trying to do that. Churn calls my function below. Invoke a JavaScript function with this stuff. So I guess... resizable user data, invoke handler for, let's do this. So let's say we will receive an init command. And then we can say web view eval And we can just, maybe we can then say let artists. So web view user data. So we get that. And then we can serialize. Can we serialize it? Oh man, because now the problem will be also that we actually need to change our music boxing to include. Okay, I think I still have a bit of time. So let's try to do that and quickly check. So yeah. We need somehow to make those artists serializable as JSON, and since they're foreign trade, they're foreign struct here, and we will need to go actually to music boxing itself and dependent sorter here. That's one of the things. We already depend on sorter, but we also will need to do sorter JSON then, because otherwise it won't work. Because of orphan rules in Rust, you cannot define foreign traits on foreign types. So we will need, thankfully, it's still our thing, it's just in a different place in workspace, so we can easily override it. If it were some library we used, we would have probably needed to create a new type over that. Okay. Okay, so we will go here, we will look at our, at those two things, we will copy them here. We can now, in principle, should be able to get the does it actually need to do something? I guess. Okay. So let's make sure that this stuff still works. Yeah, it does. But now let's do this. So we need to take this artist thing and we need to. How do you serialize stuff as JSON? I completely forgot. Sort of serialize as JSON. Okay. Construct. Serializer. Parsing JSON, constructing JSON. So here, finally. To string. Right. Can I do that here? Doesn't seem so. Let's create our own struct then. State. Here we will have artists. That will be a vector of artist. And here we will still derive serialize, right? Oh, we also need to use, right? What don't you like? Oh, true. So, sure you cannot use. Oops. So, yeah. Yeah. So we now can do that. We now can do that. State JSON. State. I wonder if we can just call like alert ourselves on the web view part with this stuff. So I think there was something like actually, I'm dumb. It's not really. Ah, God. So annoying. Okay. So here. They were calling stuff, I think. They were calling JavaScript function. Yeah, we can just do, of course, we can do webview eval, and we can then do like alert. And we can do like format, like let JS command, like format alert. Actually, I can even do like, we can do it as debug thing, and then we can just pass the JSON here. So that's our command, and here we can then do JS command. And that's kind of it, I think. No, you don't like it. Ah, sure. I wonder if I can. Seems so. So let's try to do that. Nothing. Ooh. Well, I don't care for now about that. So, what don't you? Oh, yeah, I need to do macro use stuff. I've completely forgot. No? What don't you like now? Can't find the drive macro in this scope. Can't find the drive macro. What does it didn't want? Ah. Oh my God, do we need features drive? Yes. Okay. Okay. I saw that I can just like do it like that, no? Version. Can I? Should it? Yeah. Okay, so that stuff I don't need, I think. Am I correct? I also think that then I don't need the drive to do this. I can just yank it. And then Okay, so that is nice. Now the only thing we need to actually dispatch stuff, right? So we need to go to our to this. Let's add another button. Let's say get artists. And here we just dispatch a message. Get state. Yes, get state. So that thing doesn't exist yet, of course. Let's add this thing. So we don't yet do any synchronization here. Synchronize state between front end and back end. Sure. What we will do here, we need somehow to call the JavaScript function, right? I think. So it works. Components, properties, refs. Ref, okay. Okay, let's just Google it. Call JS function from you. Ah, you can also write JS, right? Okay, I wonder if it will work. Nope. True, I think it's not even part of you, it's more like was and bin ganzen. Jazz. Shit, that's so no easy way to call anything, right? Where is this JS macro comes from? So it has like just this and stuff. So maybe up HTML is the only thing that executes it. I'm close to giving up on that, going React way. After all, Because the complexity level, of course, is mind-numbing. It's like, it's crazy. You have several things and in how they all interact, it's very confusing to me. I don't know. Like, I see that there is some JS macro. I can't even find it. Where does it come from? Awesome. I really don't want to import function. I just want to like call a thing. I want to pass a message from Rust code to Rust code, and this is almost impossible to do, it seems. It's like, so let's try to look through that again. Okay, let me quickly disable this GitLens extension because it's so awful in terms of actually navigating your code. Ah, reload required. Of course, reload required. Okay, then doesn't matter. So I don't need this file. I have this desktop thing. I get my artists. Can I just at least print them? To make sure that I actually get anything at this point. So, right? So, let's see if we at least got them in the WebView wrapper. Yes, we did. Okay, good. Even got the buttons that we just wrote, right? But this button doesn't do anything. We need to somehow generate this init thing from that button. Ah, yeah, I probably should be able to see it in the example, right? So, I really hope so. Was it actually having any handlers? I forgot. I think that was the one example where they actually didn't have any invoke handlers. Yeah, exactly. So example is useless for that. Try JS interop, whatever. Actually, you know what? In any case, we first just need to send this message. Doesn't matter if you send it from WebAssembly stuff or if you just send it from here. So, you know what? I'm like really happy and all for them, but I will just do it like that. I'll just say to, I won't even care about window unload. I will just do how the hell do they dispatch it? They was doing it from, I think, here. So they were sending some message. Window external invoke. So that's how it worked. So we can just send init, right? I also wonder because we're still running this stuff. So, okay, nothing happens here. I think maybe, I also completely forgot how this stuff looks. Oh. So we need to do function, and then we can do this. Oh. And okay. Okay, nothing happens again. Can I just do like here? Okay, at least this thing is called, but our message is not really dispatched anywhere, it seems. Ah, yeah, yeah, I'm dumb. That will only happen when I run it in WebView, right? Well, it still doesn't happen, so... Gets the artist, but there is no simple way to pass them into the state, it seems. When we load stuff here... Oh yeah, let's see if alert will actually trigger in WebView. So... Yeah, sure. And in the... Yeah, I think so. Yeah, it triggers there as well. So that works. But like... This stuff doesn't work at least. So maybe we need to like return something somehow. I'm so confused. Two-way communication is the main advertised feature of this thing as well, so... where this external thing even comes from in JavaScript? So, like... Say, window... Like working examples. No. Maybe that will work. Use that color. Okay, that looks better. External invoke. Yeah. But it doesn't say window. Maybe I need to remove this stuff. We'll just do like external. And here it says, yeah. So let's do, at least when it triggers, we should see something in the console. If we succeed, that at least is guaranteed to happen, right? Okay, so we actually received the message. But nothing happened. So init was called from this scene. Can we look at examples here? JS callback. Mm. Can we search? I'm sure that I saw some kind of macros that generates JavaScript automatically. Am I crazy? Yes, here it is. Where this thing comes from, though? Is it like... No. Okay. Yeah, I think it will take a very long time to find it here. Let's see if maybe they mentioned it in some documentation. Guide at pdocs. No, okay. WebAssembly. It's a bit sad because like the whole stuff looks so cool. You can do this hot reload, you can generate WebAssembly. But like using it is probably like right now, this is way more complex than even JavaScript frameworks. And I'm just trying to pass one little value to one thing and show it somehow. And this is already so crazy. I cannot imagine how then the whole app will work, right? Because complexity will not decrease. It will increase. The more stuff you add, the harder it will be to work with. Like, okay, let's try maybe to see here where it gets this stupid... Ah, it gets from stdweb. Oh my god. So there is like this thing. There is that thing. How many things do you need? So, yes, that's the magical thing that allows you to write JS. Isn't that beautiful? So... Oh, was it actually Wasm Bingen? Ah, no, I think that's the thing that is not supported anymore. Or use it. I remember that you thing mentioned it at some point. Like choosing your web library. Getting started. Choosing a web library. Here they were talking about this stuff. Ah, okay. So like if you use WebSys, we cannot do that. And in case of stdweb, we can. WebSys underscore. So let's see. Of course, we cannot use it like that. So you need to use WebSys. Come on! How the hell do you use this stuff? Introduction, example usage. Yeah, that's exactly what I'm writing. Do I need, like, they didn't signify that I need to edit a separate dependency anywhere. So, like, sure, let's add it as well. Why not? So now this stuff worked, and now we can try to, okay, what don't you like now? Unresolved import, really? I just resolved it. Yeah, let's remove this part. So, The problem is, like, this external stuff, is it even... So I really wonder if this is some JavaScript thingy, because I haven't seen it before. Window external. Yes, it is. This feature is no longer recommended. Okay. good way to build new infrastructure and deprecated features. The relevant FEM standards. Do nothing as per spec. Whoa. I guess then it wouldn't be linked, right? What don't you like? Well, that still exists here, at least. So external, and then can we... add search provider. Invoke. Webses. Maybe it mentions it here. Smart pointers reducing format. Okay, not relevant. Callbacks. So feels to me that this WebSys scene, call Road.js maybe, that will do something. Oh. Useless stuff. So let's try to find, yes, API documentation. Can I just do like something, I don't know, raw. No, that's a different thing. JS function. Export function, export class. This is like crazy stuff to write to just send one freaking string. Okay, you can write it like that. Okay, let's try to do it like that here then. So how do we call it? Send init, right? Export function send init takes nothing, and here it just does. What does it do? External invoke init, right? Oh yeah, let's do it into proper here, doc. Okay. Sure, maybe. Oh, come on. Okay. I can just do it differently then. Rust can also do that. Or not. Okay, I guess this magical macro doesn't work as this stuff. That is so crazy. Like, this stuff is so fragile. Why? Why do you need a freaking thing there? This is... expected comma. You don't need comma here. I forget. Oh, yes, because of that. Because of that. It needs this. Okay. We now have function send init. It should be able to call this function from here. Right? No, we cannot call it from here. Yeah. Of course, this operation is unsafe because it's external thing. Okay, it's unsafe. Unnecessary. Unsafe block. Okay. Do we actually do get state stuff? Yes, we do get state stuff. So now it compiles. It says your. And when we call it, we should see. But nothing happens because right now it does nothing in this scene. But when we compile it with this scene, we should see called init after we press get state. Yes, it works. Okay, at least we can send message from this front end here. But of course, this scene is useless because it doesn't have actually user data. And yeah, that also works. Can we somehow return the state to JavaScript? I really wonder. So, I don't know. We can try. We can see if a state JSON. Right. Found in expected unit type, of course. Can I do something like webview dot set full screen, set color, run handle, eval, drop? No, we only can do like very basic eval. Which means we will probably need to manage some kind of objects that we will need to pass around in those functions here to make it work.
To actually pass the state, which means that this stuff will be absolutely unusable in terms of complexity. So let's save it for the posterity then. Because we were, after a lot of pain and suffering, able to actually trigger an action from our front end here, but this is obviously not a workable solution. So what we will do instead, we will remove all this U stuff, I guess. We will just use plain JS for very quick proof of concept that we can render stuff at least from our music box, and we will continue to try out, I guess, React or something like that next stream. For now, WebAssembly ecosystem, it looks nice, but I think for actually building user interfaces in Rust, it's a bit too immature and it requires a bit too much manual pumping for anybody to be able to actually do anything real with that for now. So passing triggering web view handler from you. So we did that, which is pretty cool that we were able to achieve it, but next commit is dropping this stuff completely. So no webpack anymore. We will keep webview because it can update stuff, but I guess we will just quickly create an Arctic scene that can then actually call stuff. Yeah. So we are going web server. So we don't need all this stuff. Wow, that was a lot of Googling today, wasn't it? let's try to quickly set up Arctic's project. I still want to see the artist rendered on a web page, you know. I'm still committed to this one minor piece of functionality. So I want to try for at least like 15 more minutes, I hope, to do that. Oh shit, yeah, I actually need to run like in 5 minutes, okay. So we were opening this stuff, which sounds nice. So then, do we want actually to do anything here? Do we want to do it on web server part? Do we want to just generate JavaScript? Can I do it in 5 minutes? Not sure. So extractor testing static files. Okay, so that like multiple pages and stuff. Okay, sorry, I guess I won't be able to actually do it in 5 minutes, so I will finish for today. Next time then, next time we will try to go a bit simpler for that. We will not try to do WebAssembly anymore. We will try to do either plain JavaScript. Yeah, we will just try and plain JavaScript. I don't want to break my brain anymore. I just want to send JSON, get JSON, set some state. Should be pretty simple. Yeah, closing thoughts. Wasm is cool. We were able to compile stuff. We were able to hot reload stuff. That's pretty nice, yet too complex. So for now, doing actual user interfaces there, not worth the effort, I feel. It's probably a good thing if you can add like some, if you have some expensive computation and you want to do it in Wasm, but you, and I would guess Seed and other projects like that, are just not something I can recommend at this point.
WebView looks cool, really nice scene in terms of how it behaves. I guess next week, we will try to use it still. But first, we will probably set up ActX projects so we can serve stuff locally without caring about that much, and also add some JavaScript stuff there. Thank you for watching. Hopefully, we can actually render something next time. See you.